I mean, data mining is you get a lot of information in, a lot of raw data in, and you want to get the nuggets of information, hence the word mining. So the gold in the data, that's the data mining. Well, it usually starts with people saying, oh, we've got loads of data. Can we make some money from this? Is there something interesting in there that we haven't found ourselves yet? You tell us, you're the expert. That's what usually starts. So it might be big companies or medical people, doctors and hospitals. They might have lots of data. And actually, the first step usually is, what do you actually want to know from the data? Because people aren't always that clear what they're actually after. This is where it comes to artificial intelligence. So a lot of the work that we do is actually applied artificial intelligence. So you get your data, and then how do you get a pattern out? So it involves algorithms, it involves programming. It may be some mathematical or statistical systems that you want to design. Or it might be more artificial intelligence, somehow using something like evolutionary computation or machine learning in the broadest sense, for example. Sometimes you get your data and, you know, it just looks like this is how long you studied and this is the grade you get in the exam. It's really obvious. It's obviously clear correlation, perfect, yes. I mean, this is not very difficult and we can use some simple statistics for this. That's fine, so that's easy. But then, often so the data you get doesn't quite look like this. It might look a bit more messy like this. And even in that case, you could probably still do some statistics and there's probably some relationship, it looks a bit like this, but it's getting a bit more ambiguous now and it's not so obvious anymore, what is it? And sort of statistics may work and it may not work anymore. Things when it gets really interesting is when the data starts looking like something like this. So I'm sort of exaggerating a little bit now, but you do statistics and it comes back with, oh, there's no relationship because, I mean, there's like a zero relationship between things. But obviously, you and me look at this and go, oh, God, I don't know what's going on here. It's a football. I mean, there's clearly something in this data. Something is going on here. I don't understand. And that's where the artificial intelligence comes in. As experts, we look at this and we go, oh, there's something here. How can we teach the computer to get that out? There is a shape. How do we get that shape out? And then, of course, the real problem is that if it was just looking like this, it'd be easy to teach a computer. Of course, in reality, it's so messy, the data. Can't do enough dots on here, but something like this. And somewhere in here, there is this little pattern, and maybe it repeats in a few places. But it gets really hard to see now. How do you teach a computer now to get this pattern out? And of course, remember, you don't know what it looks like, the pattern. You're looking for the unknown. If you know what you're looking for, it'd be easy. That's what Google does. Actually, Google is an easy job because they have a huge database. It's just a lookup table. We don't have that. We don't actually know what a thing looks like. So you need to find something. You don't know what it looks like. It's somewhere hiding in there, or maybe it isn't. Right, now how do we do it? That's data mining, really. From this stage, there is then lots of different steps. I mean, the first thing we usually do when we get data, and it doesn't look as simple as the original one, is we do something called pre-processing of the data. We make it in a nicer shape. Maybe we ping it on a certain scale. We're actually trying to plot the data. We're just looking at it, plotting it one way, plotting it another way, two dimensions, three dimensions. Maybe we can eliminate some of the variables because they turn out irrelevant, or maybe lots of information is missing, so we can't use them. Sometimes also the data is not always numbers. It might be text, or it might be pictures, and then how do we put that in? So there's all this sort of messing around in the beginning with the data, just bringing some sort of shape, let's say, and we can look at it more easier.
So a lot of it is eliminating background noise, I suppose, is it?
Yeah, and of course the problem with that is it really noise, or is that maybe the noisy bit is the really interesting bit in the data? You know, when you get your data and it's like lots of data that's like this, and then the odd one is there. And of course the question is, well, okay, maybe that's where your sensor failed, maybe the person didn't fill in the questionnaire properly, or maybe that's actually the one data point that's really interesting. That's where you can make your money. And that's part of the question. Is it an outlier, which is something we need to get rid of, or is it actually the one interesting pattern that makes you the money, or the person that needs the drug, or whatever the question is that you're looking for.
This is statistics, isn't it?
So it would be statistics, and go back to my picture, it would be statistics if it was like this, and we can do things which are quite simple. And even in the machine learning, we still do some statistics, but statistics on its own is not enough. Has too many limitations. So we need to go beyond statistics. And that's where computer programming is really good, because it's more flexible than statistics. We can deal with text, we can deal with pictures. I mean, you can't do statistics on pictures. It doesn't work. You can't do statistics on text. We can do a pattern mining on an alphabet, we can do a pattern mining on a picture, we can do an image recognition, we can mix all these things together. We can also deal when a lot of information is missing. I mean, usually when you get these big data sets, I mean, this is one of the myths, big data. People think, oh, it's so huge data, so, you know, no problem. But of course, big data usually also means a lot of data is missing, a lot of data is messy, the data isn't always clean. And the bigger the data gets, this problem doesn't get any smaller, it gets bigger as well. So statistics usually can't cope when there is missing values or when there is mess in the data, because it has some very fundamental requirements. So for computer science, we can deal with this. Missing data, okay, we write a bit of code that deals with missing data. The data is messy, we write a bit of code that does something, massages the data, or I don't know, whatever it is. So that's where we're much more flexible than statistics. Statistics is very powerful when it works, but when it doesn't work, then computer science.
What is it? Correlation does not imply causation.
Yes.
And the idea, in layman's terms, that just because you see a pattern doesn't mean it's relevant. Would that be a way of putting it?
Well, it's like, you know, only because you're carrying an umbrella doesn't mean it's going to rain today, right? I mean, exactly. You observe things together, but what you don't know is whether they are actually, is A related to B, is B related to A, or maybe, and usually actually, there's another reason underlying it all together, which is what's happening. I mean, a lot of medical work we do, this is interesting. So we're looking at patients taking certain drugs, and we want to know whether the drug is really helping them or not. And then after they've taken the drug, something might happen to them, something you don't want. Maybe they have a heart attack. And the question, of course, is, well, was it a drug that caused the heart attack, or was it something else? And it's fundamentally important to understand that. And you can't just conclude, only because they took a drug, that's why they had a heart attack. Usually it's not at all because of the drug.
Yes, because otherwise we could say, I drank water and therefore...
Exactly. It's something called confounding in technical terms. There's lots of confounding issues and you need to understand the difference between them. You will have heard of this. It's always in the newspaper every year again. Eating salt is bad for you. Why is eating salt bad for you? Because it apparently causes high blood pressure. Where's the evidence for this? So what happens is, I looked at this. In 1988, there was some studies on this, and this is what this picture shows. And it's something in the British Medical Journal, where you were looking at different countries, and you were looking at basically urine and salt. And what's happened is, each of these dots is a different population, i.e. a different country. And they measured out of thousands of people in the urine how much salt there was. And they also measured the blood pressure, and this is the graph. So you've got this is how much salt, this is how much blood pressure, and you can see there's a sort of slight positive correlation there. And it's actually based on this study, or it's kind of a meta-study, that the conclusion was, okay, so more salt must lead to higher blood pressure. However, actually, if you look at this picture properly, you might see that, wait a moment, there's lots of points here, and there's some sort of four over there, and they look a bit strange. And actually, if you were to remove those four points from the analysis, your trend would suddenly become negative. It's only because of these that the trend is positive. It turns out that these outliers are from countries where salt isn't very popular in the diet, sort of non-industrialized countries in Africa. So, okay, actually, is it possible that this study is flawed? This data should never have been included because it's not what we are used to in Western society. And if you look at ours, actually eating salt is good for you because it seems to slightly reduce blood pressure. There has been more work since on this, and there probably is a link between salt and blood pressure, but it's not as obvious. And there may be much more going on. And actually, what hasn't been established at all is whether slightly raised blood pressure might actually be good for you, because it might also help you in other ways.
So it's not the statistic or the data itself, it's how it's...
The interpretation of it and getting the right, you know, rubbish in, rubbish out, actually making sure that what you put in makes sense. And yes, think of the confounding things. If you use data that you shouldn't have used because it's from a country which is completely different, for example, like here, right, it doesn't help.
So JPEG works by downsampling the colour components and using other techniques as well. The majority of video compression methods will do the same thing.
So you're being compressed right now, Michael.
I certainly am, yes.